Hello, everyone. I'm Caron Butler. At the moment, our country are dealing with two viruses, COVID-19 and systemic racism. Both of these viruses are especially dangerous and urgent in the Black and brown communities. Now, systemic racism was built into the fabric of this country, and we've been dealing with the impacts for generations. Now, today, please welcome the president of the NBA G League, Shareef Abdur-Rahim, who spent 12 years in the NBA, where he was an all-star and Olympic gold medal winner. Shareef, I'd first like to say thanks for giving us some time in the midst of everything that's happening in the world right now.
Well, Caron, thank you. Thank you for having me. It's good to see you, brother. Hope you and your family are safe and well.
Likewise. And, you know, I immediately have to just shift to, you know, something that's a little more heartfelt when you talk about all of our hearts being heavy. The killings of George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Ahmaud Arbery, Rashard Brooks, and countless others. How are you holding up right now in the midst of everything?
Yeah, well, I think you hit it. We all have a heavy heart. You know, we all are hurting no more than the families of those murdered, those impacted, and the countless others. Our heart and our prayers go out to them. But we're all going through and feeling the pain. But when you see, when you see the folks out demonstrating and peacefully protesting, and not just Black folks, but all colors, all ethnicities around the world, you have to be hopeful. And I think it starts with hope. And from there, we have to be vigilant. We have to stay with the work. We have to be consistent. But we're feeling pain, but I think it's a reason to be hopeful through this.
One of the reasons why, I'm glad you brought up the word hopeful, because one of the reasons I was personally hopeful, because I participated in multiple marches, Los Angeles two times, here in Wisconsin, the Juneteenth Day March. And what I noticed was on the front lines, it was a lot of young people. Also, it was a lot of people that didn't look like, you and I, so that was something different. And then you look at all states who had massive marches, you look at all countries as well. But then, I was taken back again because I see, in 2020, the year is 2020, and you're still seeing people be hung by noose. You see people putting, noose in Bubba's NASCAR garage in his location. Like, can you just talk about the impact of, how that make you feel personally?
Well, it's frustrating as a husband, as a father, as a member of community. You're frustrated. I'm from the South. I grew up in Atlanta, Georgia. Went to high school outside of Atlanta. My high school, Wheeler High School, named after a Confederate general. And as high school students, we understood this. We knew what our school represented. You go play basketball, as you knew. Who you were representing. That can be, as a young person, that can be demoralizing to see that we're, as you pointed out, that we're in 2020 and we're still dealing with these things. However, again, I point to the fact that there is an awakening that, now you see folks waking up to the fact that, hey, this needs to change. There's a petition, from a personal standpoint, there's a petition to change the name of my high school and other high schools in that area. You see, monuments coming down. I think it's becoming that this wave of folks that are hanging on to this are out of touch, outdated. And again, you were pushing forward to call for this type of action to again, we saw the response of the NASCAR driver supporting Bubba. So when you see that, again, we're hoping that this type of action just drives forward that, it's a new day, and we're calling for change, and this won't be acceptable in our communities, in our country, and folks will move away from that.
Yeah, and I'm so glad you said, eventually, hopefully folks' mindset and, dispositions will be different, and we'll shift away and move away from that. But, when you think about centuries of just trauma, unaddressed, swept under the rug, it's not going to be an overnight fix. It's going to be quite some time before we're able to really see, change happen. And, you know, sadly, you know, as a black man in America, experienced a lot of hardships personally with encounters with law enforcement. How about yourself? Have you ever had, you know, any personal encounters or someone that you love close to you had bad experiences?
Yeah, well, look, I think, and you hit it, I think in two fronts, you know, we've been confronted with it, Caron. You know, one, you know, what we're all dealing with COVID and still dealing with COVID, and, you know, how it was disproportionately impacting black and brown people, right? And then, you know, these events, these continual murders of black people, right? It highlights and brings back, you know, our history of slavery, of Jim Crow, of lynching, the systemic racism that, you know, all of this has created in our country. I don't think you, you know, you grow up as a black man and in America without facing, you know, some type of racism, you know, overt or implicit, you know, from, you know, directly in your face, the language, the tone, the way folks treat you, to just the idea that I have to have a conversation with my son about how he drives and, you know, what happens when he's pulled over. Just that anxiety, all of that going into the experience of being a black man, I think we've all faced that. You know, it's on us to be, I think, more involved, you know, locally, nationally, and connected to these conversations so that, you know, folks are held accountable and we don't have to, you don't have to feel that way. But it's, to your point, your earlier point, I think we have a lot of work and it's a long way before we get to a point where, you know, we don't have, you don't have to feel that way. You don't have those experiences.
Yeah, and speaking of, you know, a long way, you talk about, you know, just the connection with the NBA and our position and commitment to racial injustice. When you think about the 67 Cleveland Summit, that epic picture of Muhammad Ali and Kareem and Bill Russell and those guys, you know, all being together, when you see some of your G League players right now, today, you know, taking action and participating in peaceful protests and then speaking out on police brutality, what have you heard around the G League and what role do you envision the G League playing in some of these issues going forward?
Yeah, that, great question. And I'm so proud of our G League players that they've been a part of the protest, and we've seen it in our G League communities. You know, we've seen protests in Des Moines, Iowa, and Grand Rapids, Michigan, McAllen, Texas. So not just in, you know, the larger cities, the Atlanta, the DCs, the New Yorks, they're in our communities, and our G League players are committed and a part of it and, you know, putting themselves on the line as well. What we want to be able to do from a G League standpoint, we want to be a part of the change. We are establishing a change movement where, you know, even our players that may not have the same platform, the same following as NBA players, that we can help amplify their voices. At a team level, community level, we want to be a part of the conversation and bringing about these conversations and normalizing the conversations where folks understand the experiences that we're talking about. And then I think at the G League level, we have an unbelievable opportunity to have a true impact just across representation across our leagues. You know, we can not only be a platform for players to aspire to, you know, have jobs and be in the NBA, but also for executives. We see it, you know, already with, you know, NBA executives getting their start, general managers getting their start in the G League. And I think that can, you know, we can broaden that across our league for opportunities for black people.
And I love the fact that you've been vocal about the need of confronting both our history of racial oppression and then the reality of structural racism in society today. What are some of the lesser understood ways from the structural racism effects that people in communities of color are going through today?
Yeah, well, I think we have to start with understanding that it's in everything, right? It's in, because you're talking a long history. So it's in how our business practices, how folks are hired, you know, healthcare. This is, you know, all what we've seen, you know, just through COVID, the type of jobs that you have are impacting folks being affected, right? Their ability to healthcare, the stressors that they have that make them more predisposed to the impacts of COVID, right? And then you go to, you know, things that folks may miss, you know, education, somewhere that I've had a focus over the past 20 years, my wife and myself, you know, starting a foundation right outside of Atlanta to be a part of bridging the gap for young folks in their education. And we work with over 400 young people a day throughout the high schools in Southwest Atlanta. And the thing that we've seen is the resources that are available to those young people in their communities, you know, there's a wide gap between, you know, what's needed. We saw it firsthand when we went to shelter in place and young people were learning remotely. You know, in some cases, we didn't have the Wi-Fi connections to work remotely. We didn't have the technology. All of our students depended on free breakfast, free lunch. So, you know, now they don't have the meals to make it through the week. And this is not only a reality in Southwest Atlanta, it's a reality around the country and in our communities. And it's a part of, you know, this systemic racism that we talk about. We had to, in short order, you know, pull together resources to ensure that our young people could get what they needed to finish out the school year. But you have to only think of the gaps that will be in place as we come back and recover from COVID around our country, not just, again, in Atlanta.
I want to know your position, like, on this topic. When people turn on and initially see that we're talking about, you know, racism and wealth gap and all these different things, they may pivot away and they'd be like, wow, like, they're still talking about that. What would be your rebuttal to, you know, someone that thinks that way?
I would say, yeah, wow, we're still talking about that. And, you know, again, that's telling on all of us. And I think, you know, again, we have to have these conversations. And I think what's great in this moment in time is that you've seen others join the conversation. So you've seen the Bank of America's join, you've seen the Nikes join, right? You've seen around corporations around the country join. The NBA has been a part of this work for a long time. You know, I think, you know, now we have a job, a responsibility to hold folks who say they want to be a part of the conversation and be a part of the change, hold them accountable that they do that. But I would agree that, yeah, we're still having this conversation.
Yeah. Can you just think about the bravery of, you know, our ancestors when you talk about being on the front line and all you had was just, you know, faith and hope. And now, you know, us being able to, one, have massive resources, large platforms, have faith, have hope, and not, you know, drive this conversation further and further and beyond measures to, you know, pursue equality and justice for all. Like, we will be doing our culture and all people a disservice. You agree?
Absolutely. We all are beneficiaries of the work of Martin Luther King, of a Malcolm X, of a John Lewis, Andy Young, and so many others, right? And for us, you know, in this moment of time, to not take this momentum and carry it forward again in our local levels and encouraging folks to vote, in our national levels, trying to, you know, encourage reform and what we can do in our own homes, you know, we be doing ourselves and, you know, our children and those that come after them a huge disservice.
Yep. You, as a former player and damn good one, might I add, you know, slept on you, man. People sleep on you, bro. You was a damn good player, man. And a lot of people just, you know, thinking about, you know, going into the bubble of Orlando right now. Like, what is your observation on that? Like, what are some of your thoughts?
Well, I think, you know, one, I think there are a lot of folks that are craving for good basketball and to see our guys back on the court. But I think in this time, it's an unbelievable opportunity with that. You're going to have all eyes focused there on what's going on. And as relevant as our guys are, as conscious as NBA players are, it's an unbelievable opportunity of partnering not only with the NBA, with our NBA governors, with our Players Association, to bring attention to the issues that we are discussing. I can't think of a better platform. It's not a political platform. It's not another platform bigger or better possibly than to call attention to what's going on around the country.
Yeah, I totally agree as well. And when you get the question or the huge ask of, All right, Shareef, what are some of your thoughts on, you know, racism in America and all these things? And they say, if I can learn more about racism in America, if I could learn about the pulse of, you know, where we at, the climate, and where can I, you know, contribute and help and be, you know, helpful, where would you send them? What direction would you send some of the individuals to ask you that?
Yeah, I tell them, you know, historically, look at the work that the NAACP has done. I'd say look at what Nicole Hannah-Jones has done with the 1619 Project, what Brian Stevenson is doing with the Equal Justice Initiative. You know, economically, I'd say look at what John Hope Bryan is doing with the Hope organization. So, I mean, it's a ton of resources out there to learn more. I'm still learning. We're all still learning. I think it's the willingness to want to be a part of the change.
Yeah, I think that's the most important thing too. Just the willingness to be part of the change. And, you know, last thing, just, you know, everything happening, you know, how can you touched on it quite a bit, but how can the conversation continue to be moved, you know, for some of the guys that are participating in the bubble? You talked about how large the platform is going to be. Is it any strategic ways that, like, if I'm an individual and I want to continue to move the discussion on social injustice in the world, how, you know, as a player or a former player, how would you go about it?
Well, I think one, our players have been, and, you know, probably, you know, I didn't catch this in my career, but our players have unbelievable platforms just on their own social platform. So they don't need an interview anymore. You know, they don't need anyone to connect them. They have platforms themselves. So I start with, you know, being educated, you know, your previous question, and then being able to find those, you know, platforms or those ways that they want to contribute. And we've seen it, you know, the Jaylen Browns, the Malcolm Brogdon, the work that the guys are coming together to do, Chris and LeBron with the One Vote Initiative. So our players are doing it. They're unbelievable. I think the league will continue to support. From a G League standpoint, we're going to continue to support our players. The work that our WNBA players, our sisters are doing is unbelievable. So the players, WG, will continue to lead. The support of the governors and the league will continue to be there. And creating a great platform for them to keep this work going.
Hey, Shareef, man, I once again just want to thank you for your time. This has been super insightful, and, you know, I'm better from this discussion. Appreciate you. Thanks for listening, guys.
Great stuff, Caron. Thank you, and thank you for these conversations that you're having. They're extremely important.
Absolutely. Everyone be safe.